Professor, may I change the subject for a moment? And I would like to tell, to ask you about the Penrose tiling.
Yes.
This is what you discovered in 1964, as far as I remember, if I remember correctly. How is a Penrose tiling formed? This is also something incidentally that I'm still trying to grasp, because it's not easy, for sure. It's not easy to grasp that, but I find it really interesting.
It's not easy to grasp, but it's easy to make, in a sense. Yeah. You have to just take two shapes. No, that again was to some extent due to Escher. I wouldn't say that too much, but yes, that's more the Impossible's triangle. I think I was trying to do. I can't explain it, and certainly not in short terms. It was certainly playfulness. I remember the thing which started it off was I was trying to write a letter to some people at one of the colleges in London who had invited me to give a seminar. And I wrote this letter was very out of date. I had not replied for several weeks or even months, perhaps. And I had a terrible problem because I was never very good at writing letters. And I noticed instead the logo that was used on the head of their notepaper. And the logo had a pentagon, five-sided shape. Mm-hmm. Side were six pentagons, one in the middle and five around it. So it makes a shape, one pentagon in the middle, regular pentagon, five around it, and they you can make them inside a bigger pentagon. So I just thought, as I was trying to waste time and not answer the letter, what happens when you iterate this? So you put this shape inside itself and you do it again and again and again like that. And I had an interest in that from something else I was looking at previously, but that was not, let's not talk about that. And then you have to think of a way of filling the gaps because you have bigger and bigger gaps and what you do. And I had a way of putting some pentagons in the gaps. It was a little bit of a choice. You could do this or that. And I decided in doing this rather than that. Which was fortunate because, fortunate for me and unfortunate for a poor Japanese fellow who did the opposite. He followed the same procedure and did the opposite one and didn't get anywhere with it. But if you did it the way I chose, you could produce a pattern. And this pattern I thought was rather elegant, made out of pentagons, and I could fill the gaps with a few shapes. And I had a friend who was in hospital, and I thought I would cheer her up by sending a picture with this thing. So that was that. Later on, I had the feeling, maybe a bit of inspiration, I suppose. Gosh, this is a nice pattern, but I wonder whether you can make it into a jigsaw puzzle. So you could force it by putting little knobs and notches on it. So you make jigsaw puzzle pieces, which would force that pattern. The pattern was not periodic, never repeated itself. I could show you one, but probably, let me not try and find one. It would require six pieces with different the gaps between the, you have three versions of the pentagons with different ways to put the knobs go on, and the gaps, you had three other pieces. And so it was six altogether. And I remember I just got my job at Oxford, my professorship at Oxford. And I was visiting Oxford and I talked to Simon Cochin, who was a Princeton mathematician. And I talked about that I had this non-repeating configuration with just six pieces. And he said, oh, well, there is a version with squares. There was a version of a non-periodic. You could tile the plane in a way which never repeats. The first version used several thousand different pieces. And a man called Raphael Robinson has got this number down to four, not down to six, sorry, he got it down to six. And he said Raphael Robinson was somebody who likes to get the smallest number. And I thought, well, I can do it by five, because I knew my six pieces, I could glue two of them together and you could do it with five pieces. So I knew that. That's, I can do it by five, you see. And then I went home and I thought about this a bit and I played around and I cut them up and glued them in different ways. And I thought, I can get it down to four. And I was quite pleased with that. And then I thought, this is quite nice. I like the four. And then I thought, well, I wonder if I could do a bit better. And I played around and I got it down to two.
To two.
People asked me what my reaction was when I got it down to two. And I had a rather curious reaction. It was rather disappointment. You might say, well, I was disappointed. It's just too easy. I thought, this is, I don't know whether I consciously thought that, but I probably thought, well, look, it's obvious. It must have been discovered by the old Islamic Taoists and so on. They must have found this. It's much too easy. You could do it with just two shapes. I had these kites and the darts. I then found another way of doing it with two shapes, which was related to the first way. And it's usually the other way, the two rhombuses, which people use. But and I, as far as I'm aware, nobody had discovered it before. People look mm-hmm. in the Islamic tiles and they find all sorts of patterns and just nice things with pentagons, but they're not the same. Nobody has ever found one which seems to be this pattern. Curiously enough, yes, you see, John Conway got interested. I showed them in these shapes and he had long talks with Martin Gardner. And so Martin Gardner, in his Scientific American article, he'd give a very detailed description of the kites and darts, which he'd based it on from his discussions with John Conway. What was I going to say about that? Yes. Yes, there was a curious thing because in the previous, see, Martin Gardner said, next week we are going to talk about something different. I don't know how much of a description it was. He described something else of mine, which was, I think, I had a shape which I'd showed to Escher. You see, I visited Escher once and I showed him a shape which would tile the plane in a repeating way, but in a way which was what's called non-isohedral, which he'd never used before. That means that the shapes occur in two different forms. They do repeat, but they have two different versions of themselves in the repetition. And mm-hmm. and he, his last picture, which is called Ghosts, did actually use this. What I want to say is that Robert Ammann rediscovered the rhombus ones just on the basis of very limited description that Martin Gardner had given. I don't think it was much of a description in his previous article, and I find that stunning that Robert Ammann had been able to rediscover the rhombus tilings with such minimal description. And then he found some others afterwards. So he was a remarkable person. I'm afraid he died, so he's not around now. Quite an unusual person.
Okay. Oh, here we go. So one more thing which we forgot about is, I forgot about when we were talking, and we would like to add to our conversation. The Penrose Triangle, we can see the illustration. What is it? Something you devised with your father, right?
Yes, that's true. Well, you see, I had been, I think I was in my second year as a graduate student in Cambridge, and there was one of these international congresses of mathematicians, which was being held in Amsterdam. And so with a colleague, I went to this conference or congress, and I remember one of my lecturers, I was getting onto a tram, I think, in Amsterdam, and one of my lecturers had this catalog, and this catalog had this picture of Escher drawings. He said, look, there are these Escher prints in the Van Gogh Museum. And so he said that you'd be like to see that. So I went to the Van Gogh Museum and I got very completely overwhelmed by these amazing things that Escher had done. And I came away from that thinking I hadn't quite seen, I had some ideas that I thought I hadn't quite seen in that exhibition. And I started to draw things with bridges and roads and things going off in different directions. And gosh, there's a picture. I should show you those. Yeah, there is. I could show you those. Yes, like this one here. I don't know. This is one I drew later, but I don't know if you.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. See, it's got this impossibility. And my father did that with, he made this picture with the dogs. Mm-hmm. So that's, sorry, I just wanted to show you the sort of thing I was trying to draw. Yeah. This is the non-repeating things. I just thought I'd show you that too. And you can make them into shapes, so that I was trying to escherize them. Mm-hmm. I'm only just showing you the, yeah, and that is showing you an impossible, sorry. Yes, there's the impossible triangle, which we just had.
The impossible triangle, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now you see, I was drawing pictures like the other one with the bridges and so on, not as elaborate as that. And I simplified it until I got to the triangle. Mm-hmm. And then I got home and I showed it to my father. And he then found it intriguing and showed it to lots of colleagues of his who found it difficult to look at. And my father, though, developed it into buildings, which were impossible. And then he simplified this to the staircase. So the staircase was his contribution. And then he sent a letter to Escher, who then developed the staircase into the ascending and descending. And later on, the waterfall, which was based on the triangle. So we had this influence on Escher at that point. But we gave credit to Escher in the references. We said that he had done things like this. What I did not know at the time was the work of Oscar Reuterswald, who is a Swedish artist who had drawn things like, he had this picture with cubes going around, which were basically the same as the triangle that I had. But before Escher had done things like that, and before I had, I'm not sure whether he had quite the triangle, and he didn't draw it like that. He drew it with the cubes. So it's a whole slew of cubes going around in an impossible way. But that's not also original, because you can go back in art and you find there's a Bruegel, one of the Bruegels anyway. There's a picture called the gallows. I forgot, there's a bird. Not a jackdaw, what is it? It's another bird. But there's a picture of a gallows. And the top of the gallows are joined up, impossibly connected with the bottom of the gallows. Mm-hmm. So they are an example of one of these impossible pictures. So other artists have done this before. But I thought the triangle was about the basic, most simple thing you could have. I like to put a perspective in that. Escher put perspective in his pictures, but I don't think Reuterswald ever did. No, he had them straight parallel lines. But you can put perspective in, and it leads to mathematical ideas. It was much later. I remember, I don't know what it was, I was being filmed for some film which was about twister theory. So the twister theory was, I didn't talk about that, and let's not talk about it. It was a mathematical way of looking at the world, which you can translate things into a different geometry. And it was a transformation from one kind of geometry to another. So the space-time is translated into a different kind of geometry. And it was, as its elegance and its way of doing things. And at one point, they'd been filming me for a while, and they said, "What are twisters good for?" You see, something like that. So I said, "Oh, well, you can use them to solve Maxwell's equations." Maxwell's equations being the basis of electromagnetism and light. So the equations describing light are by Maxwell's equations. So they're very fundamental. The way I communicate with you is using Maxwell's equations several times over. And very fundamental to the way we modern world works now. Mm-hmm. So I said, "Well, you can use them for solving Maxwell's equations." So how do you do that? What's it all? I said, "Oh, well, it uses an idea I couldn't possibly explain." "What's that idea?" "Well, it's a thing called chromology." "There's no way I could explain that to you, sorry." So I left it at that. Anyway, I went home, and then that night I thought, gosh, I can explain it. It's explained in the impossible triangle. the triangle is an illustration of chromology. So I went back the next day and said, yes, I can describe it to you. It's in this picture. They didn't use it. I think it was too much. They didn't. I don't know why that. What happened to the movie at all? I have no idea. But it, they did show the twisters and things. Yes, they'd like to show the pictures. But
yes. So as far as the Penrose triangle, it's really worth looking at a proper page on Wikipedia, and there you can see the animation. It's really amazing. It's not easy to describe it just like that, or even show an illustration. It's worth taking a look at the animation.
I should see it because I've probably seen it, but I'm not sure what the animation is. That's not just the triangle, is it? Is it? I mean, there are very interesting things you can do with animations, and but the cohomology was something I didn't realize till much later. And the fact, you see, what it's doing is something which is locally possible and describes an object, but there is a freedom in it. The whole point with the triangle is that you can draw a corner of the triangle, say. Just imagine one corner. And you can draw that. It's still ambiguous. It looks like a three-dimensional thing, but you don't know how far away it is. So the distance from the eye is a freedom you have. And when you have a freedom like that, you can misuse it, if you like, by you using this freedom, and you go around and you're not consistent. This freedom fixes what you do here and what you do here, but then it's fixed in the wrong way with what you do at the end. And that's an illustration of a notion, a mathematical notion called cohomology. And I should say that with a colleague, I am supposed to be writing a book on Eschermatics is the name of the book. So this is Anna Tsatsos, who we're writing this book together. It's been sort of frozen for a long time because I had a contract for writing this book and I've just done nothing on it. I found a colleague to help me to write it. We're making some progress on it, and so I hope it will happen.
You never stop.
Yeah, well.
So thank you, Professor. Thank you once again. Well, as I said, I'm truly, truly inspired after today's meeting with you.
Well, thank you for the opportunity. I've enjoyed it.
Thank you so much.